think sometimes it's helpful to pause and go over terminology, because although I'd love to think that your doctor talks to you in English all the time, sometimes he talks to you in jargon. So let's lay down some of the jargon. What's a murmur? A murmur is simply turbulence of flow that the doctor can hear with his stethoscope. Now what's that? If you take your garden hose outside and you got the garden hose running, you put your hand on that hose, you probably don't feel anything. If you were to kink that, you feel that shuddering in the line. That's turbulent flow. That's something in the system which is disrupting normal laminar flow, causing, if you will, eddy currents and the turbulence that is transferred into shuddering. Now, if you could get your ear on that garden hose, you'd hear it. And that's all a murmur is. All a murmur means is turbulent flow. A loud murmur is not necessarily worse than a quiet murmur. It just indicates that there may be a problem present, or the disturbance in flow may be so minor that it's inconsequential, okay? As far as valves are concerned, we already mentioned the aortic valve. The normal aortic valve has three leaflets, and they block the flow of blood from regurgitating back into the heart. The mitral valve has two leaflets, and they are called the anterior leaflet and the posterior leaflet, very simply put. If a valve is stuck shut, the common term for that is that it is stenotic or has a stenosis, does not open all the way normally. If a valve is leaking, it can be called insufficient because it isn't sufficiently stopping the flow, so it is insufficient. Or sometimes, because the flow that has been ejected is regurgitating back through the valve, it's called a regurgitant valve. So you may hear someone talk about aortic stenosis, aortic insufficiency, or aortic regurgitation, the latter two being the same, mitral stenosis, mitral insufficiency, or mitral regurgitation, both of which are the same. And they come in degrees of severity. Now, let's take one step further with the mitral valve, because the mitral valve is a very complex structure. I'm going to give you a crude analogy. If we have a train tunnel, circular train tunnel, and I take two parachutes and tack the periphery of those up against the walls of the train tunnel, and I've got hold of the strings of that parachute, and a wind comes towards me, they're going to fold back against the wall of the tunnel, and the wind's going to come through. Cool. If the wind's going the other way, and I hold tight, those parachutes are going to meet in the middle, and airflow is going to stop. Now that mitral valve, because it's complex, can leak for all sorts of reasons. If the tunnel's much bigger than the chutes are, they're not going to meet in the middle. No matter how hard I hold, they're going to leak. If I don't hold, if I let go of the cords, which are called the chordae tendinae of the mitral valve, that valve's going to leak. If the cords break or rupture, that valve's going to leak. So it can leak for all sorts of different reasons. It can leak because where it's anchored gets too big, the chordae tendinae break, or the muscle that's holding the chordae tendinae gets loose, or the mitral valve itself gets destroyed by some disease process that causes it to shrink back. So you will hear your doctor talk about aortic stenosis, aortic insufficiency, mitral stenosis, and mitral insufficiency, but they may have different causes. There are various causes of each of those disorders.